Why Jesus? Why all the talk of crucifixions and the resurrection of the dead? The idea that our present reality can be radically transformed by one historical day from antiquity? Why does this one event persist to shake nations, stands against kingdoms, relentlessly remaining there in every test in time? Why does the life of one rabbi bring hope to the billions and peace beyond understanding, peace even in facing death? His axioms transcend culture, moving between and among every generation, offering new grace with each day to the poor and to the rich, to the young and to the old, each who calls his name. This is not just a page between the chapters of history, neither myth, metaphor, nor a line of spectacular exaggeration. His influence on every human life story is unfit to be placed into any existing category. No, Jesus isn't written into our story. Rather, our story is written into his. Every authority, even the grave, obeys his sovereign will. This is why we exalt the mighty name of Jesus over and over and over again. His victory has given us life. His mercies stand at the center of our faith. He alone holds the pen of history. He is the one true God, and at that, a God who died for us. Why rejoice? Why is this our anthem? The answer for why Jesus comes down to this. Jesus is at the center. His victory over the grave is written into every line. Between old and new, between death and life, there stands one historical reality, the resurrection of Jesus.
Great day, family. Today is truly a day the Lord has made, and we shall rejoice and be glad in it. I, of course, am Reverend Hayden Madlock, and it is my duty to bring to you the PowerPoint message for today. PowerPoint being the official online ministry of Carter Metropolitan here in Detroit, Michigan. Before I get started, I'd like to thank my friend, my pastor, my elder, that is none other than the Reverend Dr. Twana A. Harris, for allowing me to bring to you exactly what God has given me to share. Also, I'd like to thank the ministerial staff over at Carter Metropolitan CME Church. You guys are second to none. Thank you guys for being with me on this spiritual journey. So without further ado, there is a word from the Lord. Our word today will be coming from the book of Mark. This will actually be in the 9th chapter. Just a few verses we're going to skip around for. We're going to start off at the 33rd verse, and it reads, "They came to Capernaum. When he was in the house, he asked them, 'What were you arguing about on the road?' But they kept quiet because on the road they had argued about who was the greatest. Sitting down, Jesus called the 12 and said, 'Anyone who wants to be first must be very last and servant of all.'" These are the words of our Lord, our Christ, so they are already blessed. Please bow with me. Father God, for asking you for anything, Father, we thank you for being our everything. Lord, we thank you for being our all in all, Lord. And now your children, Father, are expecting a word from you, Lord. So I ask you to sit me down, Father, and stand in my stead. Let your children only hear from you and not from me, Father. You are my strength and my Redeemer. It is in the strong, matchless name of Jesus I pray. Amen, amen, and amen. So once again, we have the 12 disciples who are learning again from Christ. But this time, the lesson is a difficult one. It's a strange one, if you will. This time, the lesson is, why are you competing? So here's my question to you. Who are you competing with? Here's a better question. What prize are you competing for? We have 12 disciples who, all of their lives, all they have heard about was this coming of a Messiah. Now, unfortunately, how they learned about the Messiah was out of their control. Some historians say that in the synagogues, the Pharisees and Sadducees would always preach that he was coming as a conquering king. He would come on chariots of fire and all of these other fantastic things. But then one day our Lord shows up. He doesn't come in as a warrior on fiery chariots. No, no, no. He is born in the ghetto. He is born in a place like some of us have been born. He is raised not to be a conquering king, but to be a servant of man. He was raised as a carpenter. He was raised to work for a living, not to just sit back and bark orders. But now you have the privilege of walking with the God that you have heard about your entire life. He has been performing miracles even just at the beginning of this chapter. He has done so many miraculous things. You got a chance to watch as he was transfigured from a regular man to God. Huh. You saw him with a gown on that was whiter than white. You saw him standing with the elders. So now when he begins to tell you that someone would kill him for the second time, you're wondering, what is he talking about? Why? Because you have waited all this time for our king, and he is before you, and you know that he is God, just by what you have heard in the past, but better than that, what you've seen with your own eyes, you know that he is God. So all of these things that are actually happening in your presence, and you decide that you would argue which of you 12 is greater. Not that you're walking with the word, not that you are walking with greatness itself. Which of you 12 is greater? Don't worry, I'm not saying that this is a bad thing, because we do this right now today. We in the church are called everything but children of God. We are even called heaven hogs, because we will not share the word of God with those who really need the word of God. Oh, we don't mind sitting around and talking about who Jesus is to us, for us, and through us to other people who are in the church. But we have a problem when it comes to sharing the word of God with people who are unchurched, or people who were in the church and have decided to go by the wayside because they didn't like the way the church was being run. We have a problem with that. But we love to sit around and talk about how great we are in the Word of God. And we're not. We have all had the opportunity to backslide, and we've chosen that opportunity to backslide. We have all done some things that God would not be proud of us for doing. We have all decided to sit at home instead of go and worship. We have all done some things. So to sit around and try and figure out who's better in the house of God is more than ridiculous. But God did exactly what God always does. He's still doing this to us today. He didn't get mad at his disciples for talking amongst themselves, trying to figure out exactly who was best. No, no. This is a perfect opportunity for God to be God with us. This is a perfect time for God to be Emmanuel, because he chose this time again to teach. Oh yes, you can be the greatest. You can be as great as you want to, but understand, if you want to be first, you have to come very last. What does that mean? That means this. That means after everybody else has actually eaten, after you served every single body at the table, after you have cleared the table and gone and cleaned up, then it's your opportunity to share in a meal. After everybody has actually gone before you, after everybody's the feet have been washed, everybody's clothes have been pressed, after all of these things, then it's your turn. Can you do that? Are you humble enough to not want to be the very first in every single thing that happens in your life? Because what God told us is to follow him. You want to be great? You have to be a servant to all. Not just the people in your household. You have to be a servant to all. So stop trying to compete with everybody trying to be first. Because think about it, if you're first just by the words of our God, you, my brothers and sisters, are out of formation. For to be first, you have to be very last. Now, I'm not trying to tell any of you to start running out trying to be, trying to get to the back of the line. That's not what God was actually talking about. What God is actually saying to you is, you don't need to actually compete with anybody. To be his children, you have to do what he did. You have to be a servant. You have to be a servant of man. You have to do what nobody else wants to do. You. And then after everybody else is satisfied, after everybody else has had their fill, then it is your turn. You see, too many times, when it's time for us to do this sort of thing, the thing that pops in our head is all of the resources are going to run out. I need to be first in line, or at least in the middle. If God is telling you that you have to be a servant, if God is telling you that you have to be very last, understand that he is the source. No resource can run out if God is your source. So therefore, if you're doing what God tells you to do, not only will you have whatever it is that you are looking for, you will have it in abundance. So you won't have time to play the games that a lot of us actually play. You know, a lot of times we say that we want to be a servant. We say that we want this and that and the other. But the truth be told, we only want recognition from other people like us, or people who we deem better than us. All we're looking for is a little bit of recognition. What we fail to remember and what we fail to realize is, as long as God recognizes you as his child, that is all the recognition that you need. He will elevate you. We have to get out of our own way and understand that in life, competing with other people who are doing the exact same thing that we are gets to be a little redundant and ridiculous. If you're competing with the same person on the same level as you, what prize are you truly seeking? Recognition from people who will not even know your name as soon as you walk away from them? Or are you seeking the face of God? If you're seeking the face of God, he's not worried about you getting to him first. He's not worried about you getting to him at all, because you are already in his presence. So again, who are you competing with? And what prize are you competing for? You, my brothers and sisters, have been called to be servants, servants of the children of God, servants of the Almighty God. If you're serving God, that means you're serving the people of God. But don't get it twisted. Even in the midst of service to people, God is still elevating you. Oh, wow. I'll tell you right now that just this word right here about not competing with other people, it's speaking to me. And I don't know about the rest of you, but we have been going through a serious season of loss. We have had to tell some of my coworkers This is probably the first weekend and a group of weekends that I have not had to either attend or be part of a homegoing ceremony. It has been happening week after week after week, and right as I felt like I just didn't want to deal with it anymore, I received something in my email from my brother, my blood brother, my oldest brother. I don't know how he knew what I was going through, because I don't usually complain that much to folks when I'm doing whatever it is that I have to do. But this came to me, and it lifted my spirit, because, you know, we always say these wonderful things that, you know, it's in the Bible. No, it's not. It's in the Bible. God will never give you more than you can bear. That is so not true. Stop telling people that stuff. Stop leading them down that path. God gives you more than you can bear, just so that you can come to him instead of trying to bear it alone. So you need to understand that God gives you more than you can bear, because through him, you can bear anything. So anyway, my brother sent this to me, and I needed it at the time he gave it to me, and it lifted my spirit. And this tells you right here that you don't need to be competing with anybody. And it reads, life, it is a journey. No one is ahead of you. No one is behind you. You are not more advanced or less enlightened. You are exactly where you need to be. And it's not a contest. It's life. We are all teachers, and we are all students. This has been a word of God for the people of God, and together we say thanks be to God. Amen. And now we are ready for the benediction. Allow me to pronounce the benediction as this. Now to him who is able to do far more abundant than we can ask or think, according to the power at work within us, to him be all glory, honor, power, and majesty, now, henceforth, and forevermore. And may the people of God say amen, amen, and amen. Be blessed.